Hello and welcome to The Art of Being Human. I'm going to continue this segment from where I left off last time. We talked about emotions and how emotions affect relationships and how important it is that we have good relationships with one another and that our emotions are clear to do that. And I had made mention of the fact that nobody owns you. Nobody owns you and you do not own anybody else. And I want to kind of continue with that. I find that it's interesting when I work with people who have been abused, especially abused women. Occasionally I've worked with abused men, but most of the time it's the women that I've worked with that are abused. It can go in either direction, of course, but after a lot of abuse, women do not realize that they have the right to make decisions. We all have the right to make decisions in our lives. Because nobody owns me, I can make decisions in my life. I don't have to have somebody constantly telling me what to do. But when you have people who are abused or they've been raised in dysfunctional families, children and adults, one of the things that happens is many times they don't feel they have the right to make a decision on their own because everyone else has always told them what to do. If they're involved with a cult, people tell them who to marry. If they're involved in any kind of an abusive relationship, the person who's the abuser will oftentimes tell them everything about their lives, what they're allowed to do, what they're not allowed to do. And one of the reasons that an abuser will do that is that they do not want their abuse to be known. They do not want people to realize that they have been abusing their spouse or their friend. And so therefore, they keep them away from the public. No, you can't go to parties. No, you can't go to dances. No, you can't go to church services. You cannot be in the public because you might say something that would indicate that you are being abused by me. Now, they're usually not so forthright that they explain it that way. Usually what they'll say is, you can't go out. I don't want you to. It's not safe out there. I love you, so I don't want you going out. I want you to stay with me. I need you around here. Don't go out. And it's usually phrased in such a way that they have a need, and so therefore they want the person close to them. They want to have close relationship with that person, and they don't want that person to have friends. One of the things that cults will do, and one of the things that abusive partners will do, will try to keep the person away from other people, try to separate them from their families, try to separate them from their friends. And so if you have a family member that cannot see you anymore because their husbands don't want them to, then you should be concerned right away about abuse, because partners who are not abusive allow their partners free rein. I mean, no one would tell me, if I were married, that I couldn't see my twin sister or that I couldn't see my family. Nobody would do that. And no one would have the right to do that because nobody owns me. Likewise, I don't own anybody else. So if I were to marry and my husband wanted to watch a football game or wanted to go out with friends, who am I to say you can't do it? It's none of my business. In a marriage, it's a unique situation because you have two people, they marry each other and they become one, and yet they still remain two. Now, the Bible talks about the two become one flesh, and they do, but they still are two individual people. So you have two people becoming one in a marriage relationship, yet remaining two. They don't lose their identity. They don't lose their personhood. Neither should they. If I'm a musician, and I am, and I get married, I should have free rein to continue with the music that I do. If I marry somebody who's a professional person, they should continue to have free rein to do what they want to do. We get together because we care for each other, we love each other, we live together, we're married. But that doesn't stop me from fulfilling what I want to do, and it certainly wouldn't stop my husband, if I were married, from doing what he wants to do. So you have two people becoming one flesh and yet remaining two. The problem with abuse is that the abuser, at some core of his being or her being, realizes that they are abusive, they're restrictive, they can be verbally abusive, they can be physically abusive, and they don't want that known. They are possessing a person. This is not love, it's possession. I remember when I had a stalker. I've had a number of stalkers. They've been dangerous. I've had to have police protection at some points because of them. And I was talking to a lady that I was saying, he follows me everywhere. He calls me all the time. I would never go out with him because I know he's a stalker. I don't want to get involved with that. But he wants to get involved with me. And the lady says, oh, I wished I had somebody love me that much. And I said, that's not love, that's possession. You know, rape is not a crime of love. It's a crime of power. Who's got power over somebody else? It has nothing to do with love. It has to do with power over somebody else. Abuse is power over somebody else. And people who are abused have been told by their partners or whoever's abusing them, they can't make that decision. They can't go out with somebody and have a cup of coffee with a girlfriend or a boyfriend. They can't do anything. They have to run it by the abuser first, and the abuser's going to say no. Now, with a child, you have to say no. Sometimes you have to be aware of what they're involved with. But adult to adult, that should never be. And I saw a pastor. It was a really good thing. The pastor and his wife, there were some new people, new young people in the church. And the wife says, I would like to go out with these kids. I'd like to take them out to lunch. And the husband said, well, I think you should. Go ahead, take them out to lunch. And I'll take care of our kids at home. So he was willing to pitch in and help out. She was willing to do the things that she wanted to do, and it was fine with him. I talked with a man whose wife started a center for abused women, or for pregnant women. I can't remember exactly now. This is quite a few years ago. And he said to me, I would be a terrible man if I prevented her from doing what it is that she needs to do. If God has called her to set up a Christian center for pregnant girls, to take care of them and to help them, who am I to say you can't do it because I'm your husband? You see, there has to be such a mutuality. When you marry somebody, when you're a friend with somebody, you define the relationship, as I say, and I'll say it over and over again probably, and you come to a ground where you agree with each other as to what you can do. You help each other out. You give each other freedom. But in an abusive relationship, there is no freedom. I say you can do this, and you can do it. I say you must do this, and you have to do it. If you come to me for something you want to do, the answer is no, because the abuser does not want anyone else to find out about the abuse. If she has a black eye because he's hit her, he doesn't want her going around town and people seeing that black eye. Where'd you get that china? Not everybody walks into a door. Sometimes people get hit. And if she were to say, oh, my husband hit me, well, that's a bad mark on him, and it's also a criminal offense, and should be. So he is going to try to prevent her from meeting people. He is going to try to prevent her from having a normal life. And so if you are in that kind of situation, it just doesn't work. And you have to realize that you have the right as an adult to make decisions on your own, because nobody owns you. And neither do you own anybody else. They have the right to make decisions too. Abused people have a hard time with that. Because, and they'll come to me, do I have the right to make that decision? Do I have the right to do this because I want to? Do I have the right to do that because I want to? How much freedom do I have? And if they're just breaking out of a relationship that's been abusive and they're on their own, they can be totally confused by the freedom that they have. They don't understand how to use their freedom. They don't understand that they don't have to do everything that anybody asks. They can set their limits. I don't do everything that people ask me to do, but I try to do as much as I can to help out other people. But there comes a time when I have to respect my privacy and the things that I have to do and my own schedule. I have a schedule too. So it's a case of balance. You teach people that you're free now, you're not being abused, you can make your own decisions, you don't have to ask me for permission to make a decision. You can make decisions on your own. But if you have questions as to whether a decision is a good one or not, you certainly have the right to ask me for help. Or to ask somebody for help. Did I make the right decision? What do you think? But not so somebody's going to tell you what to do. Someone's just going to give you some input as to what's good and what's not, and then you make your choices from there. How do you teach children how to make decisions anyway? You teach children how to make decisions by giving them the opportunity to do so. So if I had a young child, say 6 or 7 years old, and it's cool out, it's cold out, and I want them to wear a sweater, I'm not going to give them the decision of, do you want to wear a sweater or don't you? Because if they say no, I'm stuck. I know they need to wear a sweater. But the decision I'm going to ask them to make is, what sweater would you like to wear? You have to wear a sweater, it's cold out. But you could wear the red one, the blue one, the green one. Which sweater would you like? So they're making reasonable choices, but I'm still in control. I've set the parameter. You will wear a sweater because it's cold, but you have the choice of which one you want to wear. And in that way, in small steps, you help a child to learn how to make decisions. So by the time they're a teenager, if they're asked to do something that they're uncomfortable with, they can say no. You teach a teenager how to say no. I know the boys, the oldest ploy in the world is, if you loved me, then you would be willing to do this, usually something on a sexual nature. And the girl, if she hasn't learned how to make decisions, is unsure whether she can say yes or no to that. And as a parent, you need to teach her, if she's on a date and somebody asks her to do something, either take drugs or snort cocaine or whatever, or do something on a sexual nature, it's perfectly all right to say no. And she will be stronger. She will learn how to say no. And it works in either direction because girls ask boys to do things too that they shouldn't do. So I'm not picking on boys here. But you have to teach people how to make decisions. And since you're not owned by anybody, you can make decisions that you think are right for you while taking into consideration how that affects other people. Certainly if you're married, your decisions, some of them have got to be in combination with your spouse's decision so that you can get together and have a mutual purpose. You're not going to just run off and do something crazy because you have the right to. You're going to consider your spouse, you're going to consider family members, and make a decision based upon what's good for everybody. But the answer is not always, no, you can't do it because I don't want you to, because I don't want people to see your black eye, because of whatever. You have the right to make decisions. If you're married, you can kind of work together on decisions. So you are able to do what you want to do and what you need to do. Other things, you need to respect each other's individuality. As I said before, two people get married, but they remain two people. They become one, yet they remain two. If I'm going to be with a person, I'm going to respect them. If I can't respect them, then I don't want to be with them to begin with. But I have to respect their individuality. They will be an individual with their interests, with their goals, with their desires. I will be an individual with my goals, my desires, the things that I want. And we work together on it. I will respect somebody else, they will respect me. You can't have a healthy relationship unless you respect the person that you have the relationship with. It won't be healthy otherwise. They must respect you and you must respect them. And you wouldn't want to have a relationship with somebody that you don't respect. You know, I've counseled a lot of women who have been abused. I wouldn't say it's a specialty of mine, but it may as well be. And I know that some women have married people because they've been told, they've come from dysfunctional families, and they've been told by their families, you may as well marry this person, you're not going to be able to, quote, do any better. Now what that says is, you're not very good, so don't expect to get somebody that's very good. If someone asked you to marry them, then marry them. You're probably not going to do any better anyway. That's very, very, very demeaning. If you don't want to marry somebody because you don't think they have the quality of lifestyle that you have, don't marry them. Don't let anyone force you into a situation where you feel you have to get married because you can't do any better. That's just ridiculous. That's not healthy. So if a person came and wanted to marry me, and I don't have anybody I want to marry, but just say for the sake of example, if I couldn't respect them, if they didn't have a lifestyle that was similar to mine, if they didn't have the same kind of faith I have, I would not marry them. It doesn't mean we couldn't be friends, but I would not marry them. I would not commit to a person that I felt was not in the way that I want to live, living the way that I would want to live. But I wouldn't want them to want to marry me either if I can't live the way they want to live. So it works out in both directions. You need to respect each other's individuality. Another thing is that you have to be tolerant of differences. Two people are going to be different. Why would you marry a clone? Why would you marry somebody that's exactly like yourself? It's wonderful to have similar interests because then you could do a lot of things together and really enjoy it. It's not an absolute must. If a mathematician marries an artist, the artist may have no interest in math, the mathematician may have no interest in art, but it doesn't mean they can't have a good marriage. It doesn't mean that they can't share a lot of things together. And then they each do their individual thing. So it's not a must, but it is a help if you have a person that you're marrying that has similar interests to yours. You have to be tolerant of differences between people. And sometimes the best marriages are those in which there is a difference because there's not the sameness. Now you should marry, if you're going to marry, somebody who has a similar kind of faith as you, because it's going to be a problem if you don't. The Bible says don't be yoked with unbelievers. Don't be unequally yoked with unbelievers, non-believers. And life will be much better if you share a faith, because then your eternal destiny, your eternal goals, what you want to accomplish is based upon your faith. Your faith determines the way you want to live, what you believe in. And if you marry somebody that does not share in that, that's a huge part of your life. And you can't share a huge part of your life, that's going to be a problem. And what will happen is you're going to try to interest the other person into thinking the way you think and sharing the faith the way you experience it. And they're going to try to get you not to do that because they're going to feel put upon and they're going to feel nagged. And they're going to try to get you to listen to them and go their way, the way that they have their faith. And it's going to cause a tension between you. And the tension's going to get more severe when you have children. So supposing one of you is of one faith and somebody is of another faith, and you have a child, how do you raise them? What faith do they follow? So it is better to marry somebody that has a faith that's like yours, and you will not be unequally yoked with a non-believer. That becomes important, very important. You have to avoid double messages. A double message is when you say something and then you say something else, and they don't combine with each other. They're like two opposite things, and it always causes confusion. You cannot reconcile the two different statements, such as, I love you, but you're such a problem to me. Well, how can you love me if I'm such a problem to you? I love you, no, I don't. I think you're wonderful, no, I don't. And the statements may not be exactly like that, but they translate like that. I think you are a wonderful person, you disgust me. You know, I just love you dearly, but you make me so angry. These statements don't compute, they can't reconcile. You're very brilliant, but you never do anything right. I love the way you're so creative, you can't do anything right. And it becomes abusive, it can become very abusive to a child, but also to an adult. It's completely unreconcilable. How can you love me but hate me? How can you say I'm wonderful but I'm despicable? It's just like black and white. How do they get together? You cannot reconcile them. And what happens, especially with a child, is they don't know who they are. They don't know whether they're a good person or a bad person or a loved person or a hated person. They just don't know who they are. But with adults, it's the same thing. And especially in an abusive relationship, that happens. I love you, you can't see your friends. Why can't I see my friends? Because I love you. You can't have any freedom because I won't allow it. But it's because I love you and I have your best. I have your best interests at heart. Well, if you have my best interests at heart, you're going to let me do things. You're not going to say you can't do it because you don't want it. If you say, no, I can't do something, give me a reason that's legitimate. And if it's not legitimate, then forget it. Give me the freedom to do what I want to do. Mixed messages are really the downfall of some relationships because they do not make sense. They cannot be reconciled. They're completely confusing. A person loses their self-concept because they don't know where they are. They don't know what you really think. And it's just an awful thing. Confused messages like that, double messages, have no place in a marriage. So you can't do that. Now, you can't change people. You have to realize that if you're marrying somebody, you're not going to change them. They do change and they do grow. I'm not saying they don't, but they do so because they want to. It's not because you can nag them into changing. You have to marry the person, warts and all. You have to love them, warts and all. They will change as time goes on, but you can't make them change. That has to be their decision to change in cooperation with you, with your help, if they want it. And if they don't want it, you have to leave it alone. So you have to, I mean, I've talked to many women who, I married this person and I don't like this, but I know they'll change after we're married. Well, they won't change after you're married. And if you try to get them to change, they'll be resistant and they won't change because they don't want to be nagged. That's one thing you have to stay away from is nagging. Constantly change this, do that, nag, 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 over the same thing over and over again. It drives people crazy. You just can't nag them. You will never have a good relationship if you're nagging somebody. So if you don't like something that a person is doing, then you have to discuss it with them. And if they're unwilling to change, you may not want to marry that person. Because they can't live up to what you want, and you're going to be frustrated all the time. And the idea is if you marry somebody and you love them, you have to let them be who they are. They will change as situations demand it. They will change and grow at their own pace, but no way can you force it. The other thing, and I'll mention this quickly, there are a lot of people in a relationship, they consider that they have to be right. And their spouses have to be wrong. If a decision comes up, one person always has to be the right one, and they consider that the other person has to be the wrong one. Well, that's no way to have a relationship either. Nobody's right all the time. Nobody's wrong all the time. And if you're wrong, you need to be able to say, I'm sorry, I missed the boat on this one, and the other person needs to be forgiving. So some people, you have to allow people to be right, and you have to allow people to be wrong. You have to allow each other to have your moments of brilliance and your moments of weakness. You can't always be the one to be right, and the other one's always the one to be wrong. That does lead to abuse. If that's the attitude in a marriage, it will lead to abuse, and you don't want that either. Well, we're going to continue next time when we come back with the things that can go wrong in a relationship. I've kind of laid them out for you, but we're going more in depth into what can go wrong. And if you've been abused, what are your feelings? What is your behavior? What is your attitude? What should be a normal relationship? And what can go wrong in a relationship to make it go sour? And I think it'll be interesting to hear this. So please join me next time.